Hey, so welcome to the cost optimization session. So this is two reasons why you should believe us when we say you can optimize your Azure costs with Ritesh Kini and Priyanshi Mittal, and me, David Blank-Edelman. So when we were looking at the cost optimization question, we thought, let's provide the thing that is most useful to our customers. But how are we going to know that? So we decided to look at the data for Azure Advisor, which gives recommendations to our customers on how they can optimize their costs and get the most value for what they're trying to run in Azure. So when we looked at those and we looked at the top recommendations that Azure Advisor gives out, we saw that there were two that stood out that we thought we should talk about. So let's go take a look at the first one. Okay, so let's go into Advisor and see what recommendations we have. So the recommendation we're going to talk about first today is this one right here. Right-size or shut down underutilized virtual machines. So I thought I'd bring to the studio an expert on this. Hey, Ritesh, I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about right-sizing.
I would love to. Let me jump right in. So here's an example of a recommendation that we show for virtual machines for right-sizing. In this specific example, we suggest that you can change your Reco test VM from a D16 V3, which is a 16 core VM, to a D4S V3, which is a 4 core VM. In doing so, you will save $10,000 on yearly Azure costs. Not bad for a single recommendation, right? Let's walk through how we produce this recommendation. First, we start by looking at the utilization of each VM across the Azure fleet. Don't worry, we have no idea what you're running on this VM or who's running it. We just boil down the telemetry to CPU, memory, and network utilization in the form of percentages. This chart shows the utilization over the last 7 days. As you can see, the utilization of CPU, memory, or network never goes beyond 28% in this case. The shaded red area represents underutilization, which in this case takes up majority of the chart. The workloads running on this VM simply don't need the power that this VM is capable of. Another way to look at underutilization is with buckets. Let's say this is the utilization over the last 7 days. It comprises of data points collected every 30 minutes. And over 7 days, that translates to 336 data points. For ease of calculation, we just take the 95th percentile while figuring out our recommendations. The 95th percentile considers most of the high load while ignoring some non-typical spikes. Let's say in this case, the 95th percentile of CPU is 10%. Similarly, this is the utilization of memory over the last 7 days. However, in the case of memory, we take the 100th percentile or simply the max value observed over the last 7 days. There's a difference in the percentiles that we consider for CPU and memory because most workloads can handle the CPU peaking out. But if the memory peaks out, there is a risk that workloads can crash due to out-of-memory exceptions. Performance and reliability is the number one thing that we think about while generating our recommendations. We want to make sure that those aren't impacted at all. So the P100th of memory in this case is 9%. We can represent the total capacity of virtual machines in the form of buckets, such that if the bucket is filled up, it means that the resource is being utilized completely. In this case, since the P95th of the CPU is 10%, the bucket is filled up only at 1/10 of its capacity. And memory is filled up even lower than that. As part of our right size recommendations, what we're trying to do is get you to move to a smaller size bucket such that the utilization is increased and the empty space in the bucket is minimized, while at the same time making it cheaper for you to run your workloads. The D16 V3 is a 16 core VM with 64 gigs of memory. We can quadruple the utilization of the workload by moving to a VM that is 1/4 the size. So by moving to a VM that has 4 cores and 16 gigs of memory, the CPU utilization can be moved from 10% to 40%, and the memory utilization can move from 9% to 36%. Similarly, if we go to an even smaller size, the utilization can go up even higher. Thanks to the number of SKUs available in Azure, it ensures that we always have enough sizes to choose from. So how do we land on the right size to choose? As the title suggests, it's with the form of targets. We identify what we want the ideal max utilization to be based on the type of workload, and then try to choose a size that gets the utilization up to that target without going over. You might be wondering, what is user-facing and what is non-user-facing? Or you might be wondering, how do we even know what is user-facing workload and what is a non-user-facing workload? I'll answer the first question first and discuss the second question later, because that's where some of the magic really happens. User-facing simply implies that it is processing user requests directly. Non-user-facing implies that it is processing batched or scheduled requests. User-facing workloads are more critical in nature because they are directly processing user requests, and that's why they have a lower target of 40% for CPU and 60% for memory. Non-user-facing workloads have a target of 80% for both CPU and memory. This is how we finally land on the right size to recommend, by figuring out the size that gets you closest to the targets. So now let's discuss, how do we know if a workload is running user-facing or non-user-facing? So this is the magical part. Our super smart friends in Microsoft Research did some investigation and found out with high degree of confidence that it's possible to categorize a workload as user-facing or non-user-facing simply by looking at the waveform of the load average of the VM. They published this paper where it has some very interesting details on how they came up with this research and, you know, how they landed on the conclusions. Definitely check it out. It's extremely interesting. So now let's go back and figure out how we come up with the recommendations that we show an advisor. We start with collecting the utilization information. We get that from the Azure host machines that run the VMs. Again, we don't know who the VMs are run by and what kind of workloads are being run. We simply know, you know, what the CPU, memory, and network utilization is. The metric information is available, is sampled at 30 seconds and aggregated over 30 minutes. When we're aggregating, we take the max values just so that we're ultra conservative when we come up with the recommendations. As always, we don't want to impact performance or reliability when you adopt our recommendations. Finally, we consider the last 7 days of utilization while figuring out our recommendations. So now let's look into exactly what happens to derive a recommendation. We first compare the current utilization with the capacity of the VM it's currently on. We identify the type of workload it's running, the user-facing or non-user-facing part, and figure out what the target should be based on that workload. Then we'll take a look at all the different sizes available in Azure and see which size can get the workload to the right target utilization. We don't want it to go over. It's going to be as close to the target as possible, but not go over. And then finally, we pick the cheapest option so that you get the most cost optimization while keeping the performance and reliability intact. So finally, what we land up with is a recommendation that moves the utilization from something like this to something like this, which means you get to optimize your costs while keeping your performance and reliability intact. Pretty cool, right, David?
Yeah, that's really cool. Well, so I would like to also take a look at a second recommendation here, since we're on a roll here. Okay, so let's go back into Advisor and see our second recommendation for this session. So this recommendation is buy virtual machine reserved instances to save money over pay-as-you-go costs. So I'd like to bring another expert on to talk a little bit about reserved instances. Hey, Priyanshi, I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about reserved instances.
Hi, David. Absolutely. Let me jump right into what are reserved instances, or also known as Azure Reservations. If you have consistent VM usage that supports reservations, buying reservations give you the option to reduce your cost with same configuration, same reliability, and same performance, but reduced costs. For example, when you continuously run instances of VMs, you are charged at pay-as-you-go prices. When you buy a reservation, you immediately get that reservation discount. The resources are no longer charged at pay-as-you-go rates, and Azure Reservations help you save money committing to one-year or three-year plans for multiple products. Why would you buy reserved instances? They save up to 72% on your pay-as-you-go costs. After you purchase a reserved instance, you don't have to redeploy. The discount is automatically applied to matching resources. You can commit to one-year or three-year plans wherever available. It's also an advantage for our Azure teams so that they can optimize the capacity planning for VM instances effectively. Now let's look at what data points we use in the recommendation engine to get the right recommendations for you. If your resources are shut down regularly, the simulation won't find any savings and no purchase recommendation is provided. So it looks at currently deployed resources for VMs. It takes into account any special discount that you may have on your pay-as-you-go or on-demand prices. It looks and aggregates usage across multiple days, including 7, 30, and 60 days. It also considers any recent reservation purchases that you have. And lastly, it also calculates usage for each and every Azure subscriptions. Then it provides recommendations with projected savings and potential projected usage and potential savings. Now that we've looked into what data goes into the system, let's also look at how these recommendations are calculated or simulated. The recommendation engine evaluates the hourly usage for your resources in the given scope over past 7, 30, and 60 days. Based on the usage data, it simulates cost with and without reservations. The costs are simulated for different quantities, and the quantity that is recommended maximizes your savings. The recommendations in Advisor are based on single scope and are based on last 30 days usage. Let's look at a very simple example here. So in the chart, you see that your VM usage fluctuates from using 35 VMs to up to 70 VMs every hour. Now, how would the recommendation be calculated since it's been fluctuating a lot? So the recommendation looks at the most consistent usage. So in this case, though the most consistent usage would be around 40, it may recommend the quantity to be 45 because the utilization of the reservation might not be 100%, but it will give you the maximized savings. Now, how do I get these recommendations and how do I purchase these VM instances? VM recommendations are available in Azure Advisor. Recommendations are also available in reservation purchase in Azure portal and also in Cost Management Power BI app. And you can also get them through our APIs. When purchase the quantity that Azure recommends, that will give you the maximum savings possible. The recommendation quantity and savings are for a three-year reservation where available. If a three-year reservation isn't sold for the service, the recommendation is calculated using one-year reservation price. Isn't that cool, David?
Yeah, I find all these things really cool. Like being able to see behind the scenes how we calculate this stuff is really super interesting. So if our folks watching this want more information about what we've been talking about, both about right-sizing and reservations, they can check out these docs on Microsoft Docs. And I want to bring Ritesh back, if we can, for a moment. So I think that people who are watching this live are going to have questions for you. Would the two of you be willing to answer some questions from people?
100%.
Great. Absolutely. Okay, so let's switch back to the live environment.